Good morning.
Good morning.
And a very warm welcome John to our service this morning. Welcome also to Alison, who's leading us in worship. And Nanda actually sent on her love to you all and says that you have to sit on there next Sunday. The first intimation is in from Presbytery. Intimation is hereby given that a meeting to be held in Palmerston Place Church on Tuesday the 15th of November, the Presbytery of Edinburgh and West Lothian will take up consideration of the report of the Presbytery Deployment Group and will recommend that the Presbytery approve the Presbytery Mission Plan. The congregation is hereby cited to attend for their interests at 7:30 in Palmerston Place Church. It is suggested that a minister, Presbytery elder, plus one other, should attend as representatives of the congregation. I order the Presbytery of Edinburgh and West Lothian, Dr. Hazel Hastie, acting Presbytery class. Not in the new meeting, and we are sending our representatives. You've probably heard us talking about the Presbytery plan over the last few months. It's now getting near to end. It's actually going to be approved. So our board and kit session are meeting with Colgate Arnold and kit session this Thursday at Colgate at 7 p.m. to discuss the Presbytery plan mentioned in the citation. The next team time, which is for primary 7 and upwards, is this evening at 6:30. In the church hall. Next Sunday is Remembrance Sunday and will be a night service at Colgate Harwood. You can buy a pocket cross or make a donation to Pocket Scotland. And just one more donation comes, and that's from Rome.
Good morning.
There's
a shoebox in sight. That's because they all were collected this week, so on behalf of Blythewood Care, I'd like to really thank you for your amazing response this year. We managed 53 more boxes than last year, so in total we've sent 126 completed shoeboxes to Eastern Europe, and ours will be in the first batch heading to the borders of Ukraine, for some to go into Ukraine and some to be at the countries that border the edge of Ukraine. We also managed to raise £512 in donations, and through the sale of the shoeboxes we already wrapped, and Eleanor at Polbeth had actually already made up boxes which she sold because people found that easier to be able to do it this year. So compared to last year we only sent 73, so 126 was amazing, and £400 last year, so again that amount had gone up. We do have to acknowledge that West Calder High School also took part in the project, and they kindly wrapped and donated 21 of the 126. So thank you once again for all your support, and there's always next year, so I will be back.
A very good morning to you all who swam here or came by canoe or kayak and came by the burns and rivers that were presented before us today. Good to see you all, and we welcome those who are worshipping from home. Let us continue with our call to worship. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. We now sing our first hymn this morning. It's CH4, number 103. Fill your hearts with joy and gladness.
Thank you.
He guards the paths of justice and preserves the way of his saints. Let us pray. Almighty God and wise Heavenly Father, we are in awe of your creation in all its fullness. We humbly come to you, acknowledging that it is only through you that can obtain true wisdom. You are the source of all knowledge, and apart from you, there is no truth. We know when we try to do things in our own strength, it can lead to disappointment and failure. Forgive us that sometimes, in foolishness, we try to do things our own way. Direct us to have complete dependence on you every day for your wisdom and direction. Teach us to love your righteous instruction. Allow us not to see it as a hindrance. Guide us, direct us to be nourished daily from your word, so that you can bring the greatest sense of order into our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Good to see you all this morning. I have a question for you. Do you know what a proverb is?
No.
No? Well, that's good, because you're going to learn today. In the Bible, there's a book called Proverbs, and it's associated by King Solomon. And in there are lots of advice on how we should live our lives. And a proverb is a saying that imparts wisdom and advises someone for the good to help them in their lives. So now we're going to hear Douglas, not that Douglas, but this Douglas, tell us what wisdom is. Let's watch the video.
Today we're going to be talking about one of the most important things that you can have in your life. Hey guys, me again, Douglas, and today I wanted to talk to you guys about wisdom. Yeah, wisdom. Wisdom is one of the most important things that we can have in our lives. The Bible talks about wisdom a lot. Yeah. The Bible says that even if it costs you all you have, go get wisdom. Wisdom is that important. And specifically, godly wisdom. But we're going to talk about that in a minute. But when I was thinking about this topic, I really wanted to know what the difference is between wisdom and knowledge. Right? Both are kind of big words, but really, knowledge pretty much means what you know in your head. But wisdom is using what you know to make good choices. Yeah, if knowledge tells you something is true or false, wisdom tells you if something is good or bad. One of my favorite explanations of what wisdom is versus what knowledge is knowledge is knowing that a tomato is a fruit and not a vegetable. And wisdom is not putting that tomato in a fruit salad. Because that would be really nasty. And just because you have knowledge does not mean that you're actually going to make the wise choice. See, like, for example, I know that a wasp is way meaner than a honeybee. And I also know what a wasp nest looks like and what a honeybee hive looks like. But I saw a wasp nest and I still went over there and poked it with a stick, which did not turn out well. I got stung all over the place. And I should have known. I did know. I had the knowledge that this was a bad idea, but I still did it. I was being unwise. And the Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, which is a really difficult thing to understand unless you sit down and think about it for a little bit. Because when it says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, it's not saying that you should be scared of God all the time and then you'll be wise. No, the only way that you can truly be wise. Yeah, there's two kinds of wisdom. There's godly wisdom, and there is earthly wisdom. And we want to have the godly wisdom. We want to have the wisdom that Jesus had. We want to have the ability to know right from wrong. We want to have the ability to know what is good and bad. We want to be able to make wise choices. And if you want to be wise, the Bible says all we have to do is ask God, and He'll help us to be wise, which is awesome. I know I want to be wise. I want to make the wise choice so I don't get stung up by wasps and things like that. But also just all kinds of things in life. Aside from being stung, there's all kinds of things. Wisdom is useful in just about everything. In fact, I'm having a hard time thinking of something where wisdom is not useful. So knowledge and wisdom are a little bit related because you need knowledge to have wisdom. But just because you have the knowledge does not mean that you'll have the wisdom. So it's a really good thing to read your Bible and to know what's in it. You know, like in Sunday school, if you have all the answers, that's fine. But if that's all you have is just the answers in your head, but you don't live out what you're learning from the Bible, then all you have is knowledge and no wisdom. So my challenge to you guys today is that you would get knowledge, but most importantly, that you would get wisdom. That you would ask God to help you to be wise, and that you would search for wisdom with all your heart, everything that you've got, because there are very few things in this life that are as important as godly.
There you have it. Douglas has explained it all, hasn't he? Yeah. And he was a bit daft poking the wasp nest, didn't he? He had the knowledge, but he made the wrong choice and still went ahead and poked the nest with a stick and he stuck. But in the book of Proverbs, there's lots of different sayings. And one day, when you're able to read all of that, they'll help you in your life. And now we're going to sing a song, and the older children, if you would like to stay, I'll give them a choice to either stand or wiggle in the seat. And as youngsters, we'll stand and we'll follow the song. There's a little girl going to show us and sing the song, show us the actions, and we're going to have fun. And just do your best to catch up with the little girl who's going to teach us the wisdom song. So let's be upstanding, and the grown-ups can join in as well.
Never can be destroyed. It's worth more than the walls and swords.
is always. This morning is from the Old Testament, from the book of Proverbs. I'm reading the whole of chapter 2. Listen to the word of God. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding. Indeed, if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver, and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He holds success in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose way of life is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair, every good path. For wisdom will enter your heart, and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will protect you, and understanding will guard you. Wisdom will save you from the ways of wicked men, from men whose words are perverse, who have left the straight paths to walk in dark ways, who delight in doing wrong and rejoice in the perverseness of evil, whose paths are crooked and who are devious in their ways. Wisdom will also save you from the adulterous woman, from the wayward woman with her seductive words, who has left the partner of her youth and ignored the covenant she made before God. Surely her house leads down to death and her paths to the spirits of the dead. None who go to her return or attain the paths of life. Thus you will walk in the ways of the good and keep to the paths of the righteous. For the upright will live in the land and the blameless will remain in it. But the wicked will be cut off from the land and the unfaithful will be torn from it. Thanks be to God. Our next hymn from CH 4 is 465, Be Thou My Vision, and we sing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5.
Thank you.
slides in your top five reading list. And have a look at the next slide. What genre of books speak to you? When you go into a bookshop or buy e-books for the Kindle or your iPad, what genre do you search for? For some, it might be romance, or classic novels, or a good mystery story. For others, a biography. And when we think of the Bible, it's got the lot. Romance, David and Bathsheba, Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebecca. Then there's classic novels, the story of Rahab, Deborah the judge. Then there's self-development, Moses and the epic journey from Egypt into the promised land. What about Jonah? And then there's Saul of Tarsus, the great Jewish leader who became the champion of Christianity and changed his name to Paul. Murder mystery. Well, we've got the story of Joseph and of Joshua. Biography. Yep, got that too. We've got the Book of Ruth. And of course the Gospels, depicting the account of life of Jesus. The Book of Proverbs doesn't hit the top five Bible books. And it might not even be in the top ten. But if I was a betting person, I would say that there is a proverb that speaks to each one of us at different stages in our life's journey. And which genre does it fit into? Classic novel? Murder mystery? Biography? Self-development? Well, I would say self-development and self-help. It offers more advice on most situations that we encounter in life. And I wonder which proverb would have helped this individual. Perhaps Proverbs 21, verse 20. A fool and his money are soon parted. The heading Proverbs of Solomon introduces the book as a whole, but it does not indicate that Solomon was the author of all the material in it. The book of Proverbs is very direct and earthly, which is the nature of wisdom literature, as it seeks to pedagogically effective ways to illumine life situations and so guide the unwise into wise choices concerning how to shape their lives as members of the human community that lives under scrutiny and the providential rule and care of the Creator. Throughout the book, reverence for God and reliance on Him are set forth as the path to life, prosperity and security. Such godly wisdom is a virtue tree of life that yields the happy life that God fashioned the creation to produce. And although Proverbs is more practical than theological, God's work as creator is especially highlighted. The book condenses King Solomon's vast reservoirs of knowledge and wisdom. It offers advice for living a fulfilling life in society, guided by the principles of love, righteousness, compassion, justice, and mercy. And wisdom is the overarching theme of the book. The people of the Old Testament prized wisdom. They knew it was God's gift to them. The theme underpins this book. But the book reveals a worldly wisdom that offers a compass for the journey of life as we navigate the different experiences we encounter in life. And we see this in Proverbs 2. It tells a story of a young man starting out on the journey of life. And the storyteller is giving him guidance. He is extolling the gifts of wisdom. It's as if the writer is setting out the principle, the guiding principles, that moral compass that will best serve this young man for his life's journey. It is both an inward journey to God and an inward journey to greater self-awareness that will enable him to develop his own innate wisdom built upon the foundations of holiness, goodness, truth, justice, and peace. It's from this place that he will find the strength, resilience, and moral fibre to live a good life that is worthy and honourable, based upon the teachings of the Torah and parental example of living this good and godly life. The message of Proverbs 2 is timeless. It speaks to all generations, and it reminds us that to grow as individuals, we need to be rooted in God's presence and to listen to the stirrings of our soul. For it's from this place that we find direction, courage, and God's Spirit within us, directing us forwards. Carol Jung reminds us of when he said, he reminds us of this when he says, bidden or not bidden, God is present. And it is from the starting point of our connectedness to God and all of creation that we learn to value ourselves in relationship to others. We read about it in Proverbs 2. This young man is guided to carefully consider the relationships he makes, to choose wise teachers and mentors, and to stay close to God's teachings as he searches for insight and meaning. Our Celtic ancestors had a wonderful phrase that fits well with the thinking of Proverbs 2. They call it Anamkara, soul friends. And what does it mean? Well, we'll read about it on the next slide. And then my soul saw you and said, there you are, I've been looking for you. It's an expression that reminds us that our mentors' godly wisdom guides us long after they have departed, for their wise counsel continues to resonate deeply in our soul and continues to direct our footsteps in whatever paths we are called to take. Let me show you another slide, which for me sums up the entirety of Proverbs 2. Every man's life is a fairy tale written by God's fingers. Everyone's life. I don't know how you react to this, but it's a wonderful turn of phrase. If you think about it, fairy tales have their own set of moral values to teach young children about the dangers of straying from the right path. For example, Hansel and Gretel, Pinocchio, Little Red Riding Hood. In essence, what they are saying is, choose well and your life can be blessed, or stray too far from doing right and your life will be far less blessed or charmed. It can lead to the path of ruin. As Proverbs 2 reminds us, God's presence is within us. It's the innate wisdom that we carry within us that equips us for all the challenges that life brings to us. And our role is then to seek God's wisdom. Keep our ear attentive to our soul's stirrings and be attuned to the holiness in all our aspects of our living. Amen. Now we're going to reflect on the words of Mission Praise 544, Open My Eyes. And you can sing along if you wish to.
Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Father God, as we lay before you our financial offering, we give you all that we are and everything you have entrusted to us. Bless these gifts of money for use here in West Calder and in the service of your world to the glory of your name. Loving God, creator of the ends of the earth, source of all that is and has been and will be, giver of life, we join together to worship you. We thank you for the wonder of our world and for the vastness of the universe, for all that you have made and for the place you have given us within your creation. We marvel at the beauty and variety of this earth, its wonderful mixture of plants, animals, trees, birds, mountains, valleys, streams, oceans, and so much more, even the rain. We thank you for everything that lifts our spirits, that moves us to wonder, that holds our attention, that captures our interest. We give thanks that you have brought order out of chaos, which we can depend upon, explore and understand, an order that reflects your wisdom and purpose and reveals your guiding hand. We join together now in a few moments of silence to make our own personal prayers for the things that are concerning us today. Lord God, we pray now for others, ultimate source of all hope. And we ask that you would use your people, your church, to bring hope, healing, and light into the darkness today. Lord, we hold before you also those who carry heavy burdens of responsibility for our leaders, local and national, and around the world, for those whose decisions will affect the lives of many, and today especially, we pray for all those gathering in Egypt for the Climate Change Summit. Grant wisdom and compassion, we pray. Lord, we give you thanks for those who carry burdens of responsibility in our church, locally, nationally, and globally. May the Spirit of truth and wisdom guide and protect all who serve in whatever capacity, that you might be glorified in all our world. For we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our final hymn this morning is hymn 604, Holy Wisdom, Lamp of Learning. And we sing it to the well-known tune, Ode to Joy. With you all this day and forevermore.